It's wonderful to see today that the conference has started with a lot of talk on teacher empowerment, teacher preparation, and how teachers need to be our biggest investment. I would like to thank the organizers here, Dr. Swati, for putting this together and really bringing into focus a very important issue of teacher education. Before I start talking about teacher education, I would start with talking about my own education. When I was 5 years old, my teacher slapped me for helping another kid doing a math problem. When I was 8, my teacher wrote on my report card, "I cannot sing," and I never tried singing after that. When I was 13, my brother offered to help me with a science concept that I was struggling with, and I told him not to waste my time. At that point of time, understanding was not important. What was important was just memorizing those facts and regurgitating them in the examinations. At 23, when my father was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, I was sitting outside the doctor's room, waiting and my stomach churning with the stress of my impending loss. And that visceral feeling took me back to my school days when I was taking my grade 12 examinations. Despite these two situations being so different, they had the same effect on me, which was trauma and an all-consuming helplessness. Years later, I realized that I was not the only one who experienced the education system as disempowering and oftentimes cruel. And my story is joined by millions of stories of children in our country who continue to suffer in our institutions of learning. It is really no surprise that India has one of the highest youth suicide rates in the world. And one of the biggest reasons cited is failure in exams or the fear of the same. I want you to watch a little video and it'll give you a glimpse of a classroom. So does this look familiar? Yeah. So I see a lot of nodding in the audience. And what do you think? What percentage of schools or classrooms still function like this in the country right now? Any guesses? Okay, I hear 90, I hear 60, 98. Yeah, it's closer to that figure, I guess, 98. Out of 1.3 million schools in this country, it would be hard to say that there are more than 100 schools that would do anything different. The stick might be missing now, but it's there. Yeah, not seen, but it's there. So, is it safe to say that majority of us grew up in this kind of an environment, in this kind of a classroom? So people in this room, can you relate with this? It might seem a bit exaggerated, but isn't this true? Yeah, yeah. And similarly, our teachers have grown up in this environment. And when people grow up seeing this kind of a classroom, the whole conception of learning and teaching is that fear is essential for learning to happen. So you need a stick. Rote memorization is more important than analytical thought and critical thinking. And all self-worth is reduced to your marks and grades in examinations. The struggles of our teachers are actually mirroring the struggles of our children because our teachers are growing up in these classrooms. The prevalent model of teacher education in the country is actually a stark resemblance of the schooling which is assembled around rote memorization and examinations. So when our teachers do not experience any progressive pedagogy in the schools that they're growing up in, or in colleges where they're being prepared to become teachers, then how can we even imagine that they can discover the vast potential of education? It is really very simple to blame teachers. that teachers are like this, they're not doing that, they're instilling fear. But is it really our teachers failing? Or is it we as a system that's failing our teachers by failing to prepare them the way they need to be prepared? So if we want to reimagine classrooms for our children, then the first need is to reimagine classrooms where our teachers are being prepared. And here today, I want to share a few insights that I've had through my own work, uplifted by the possibility of what teacher education could be or what teaching could be, and pained by seeing the condition of classrooms in the country and children being denied the basic human right to quality education, I decided to start work in the field of teacher education. So 6 years back, when I was already 10 years into education, I decided to pack my bags, packed my two children, and went to do my master's in instructional leadership at Harvard University with the intent of looking at some of the finest models of teacher education in the US. So there I looked at various models, from Boston teacher residency to Harvard's own teacher preparation program to Teachers College at Columbia or Stanford, or looking at Wheelock College and Bank Street College. These are really celebrated models, and I discovered a lot. So through my own work as a teacher, as a leader, and as a teacher educator, and my study into these models, and also the latest research in teacher education, I've been able to draw out 4 insights about teacher education. And that also forms the work that we do at I Am a Teacher. So the first insight that I would like to talk about is the power of practice. So if we need to prepare good teachers, they need to see good practice. Fortunately, as an educator, I've come across some beautiful practices across the world, and I have been able to document some of them. So a few years back, when I was talking to one of the teachers, Minati Didi in Merambika, which is a very small, free progress alternative school based on Sri Aurobindo's philosophy in Delhi, I was having a conversation about, she is an early years educator working with 4-year-olds for more than a decade, and she was talking about sand play. So I'm going to kind of share some excerpts from my documentation. So this is what she says. Young children cannot estimate their hand and leg movement and how much force to apply while playing with sand equipment so as to not hurt other children. With experience, this estimation develops and they do not hurt others. When teachers observe children play, they understand the natural inclinations and the personality of a child. For example, when children carry water from a tub to the sand pit, some use big containers while others use very small spoons. Teachers understand that children using big containers believe in their own physical strength. They want to explore their strength. Teachers put their effort to understand children's rhythm and not form a conclusion. Observing children play, teachers understand their social ability, their resourcefulness, how they deal with problems. For example, while playing, if a child likes another kind of a container and wants to have it, how he or she will respond to this desire. This tells teachers a lot about the child. Will he or she snatch it from another child, ask for it, or look for another one? Teachers observe this and see what is behind the child's action. Then Minati Didi goes on to describe how sand play promotes acceptance, socio-emotional learning, empathy, imagination, and also aids language development, skill of measurement, estimation, and develop concepts like dry and wet. Now all of this is coming together in her classroom. Imagine her working with children in her classroom, and that would look very different from this kind of a classroom, right? So imagine her observing children, understanding their needs deeply, and her conception of learning and teaching is drastically different. And if we place a new teacher, a novice teacher, or a student teacher into her classroom, she would be forced to question her own conception of learning and teaching, her own conception of education. And that really defines the first insight, which is the power of practice. So observing good practice is extremely critical for new teachers to be prepared. Just like for our doctors, we have the whole residency. We have medical schools, medical colleges attached to hospitals. The need is really to attach K-12 schools with teacher preparation colleges. That's really the need of the hour, given that 99% of our classrooms are like that.
Very good.
There are very, very few classrooms in the country which are child-centered, and each one of those need to be used for new teachers to learn from. Now the question arises, how do you really develop those eyes in teachers, in the new teachers, that would help them to appreciate what Miniti Didi is doing with her children? So this brings me to my second insight, and that insight is about intensive mentoring and coaching. So here I would share my own example. When I was a novice teacher, and I was told that observing children play was important, and I maintained detailed anecdotal notes. However, I was struggling with how to use that in my practice, and I spent a lot of time documenting those notes and not truly listening and observing. Then my mentor one day really helped me reach the insight that it is when you truly observe a child, it is then that you connect with that child. That's the highest form of love and acceptance and understanding a child. The human soul doesn't want to be advised or fixed or saved. It simply wants to be witnessed, to be seen, heard, and companioned as it is. And I'm quoting Parker Palmer here, and this was the insight that my mentor helped me arrive at. Now, mentoring is an extremely essential process in the process of learning and teaching. Teachers are seen as repository of knowledge. They're supposed to contain our knowledge. But here we need a person who can help the teacher question, who can help the teacher reflect on her own experiences and inquire into her own thinking. And that's what our principals, our teacher educators, administrators, supervisors, and inspectors need to do. We need to move from evaluating our teachers to really coaching and mentoring them, from judging them to taking them to learning. So that's the second major insight. That makes me move to the third insight, which is, if we want self-directed learners, then we need self-directed teachers. What does that really mean? So if we want our teachers not to be telling children or just putting in information, we want them to be able to construct their own learning, then we as principals and teacher educators and administrators can't be directing our teachers what to do and what not to do. We would have to enable them to construct their own understanding of learning and teaching. And the answer is very simple. It lies in demonstrative constructivist pedagogy. Here again, I'll use the example of my own classroom. So I work with student teachers, I work with the groups of students teachers, and this year while I was working with them, couple of months into our program, so I asked them, how is it going for you? And they said that, after a month we were wondering when the teaching is going to begin. And then I understood their whole conception of teaching was getting information, receiving information and telling. And in the absence of any lectures where we were going through certain experiences together and we were debriefing those experiences and relating it to our own lives and with real examples around us in the world, they realized that their conception of learning and teaching wasn't that. And a couple of weeks later, when we gave them the vocabulary and the language and the theoretical constructs to understand what had happened, they knew that the learning had already been constructed in the first month. So now, I have spoken about the practice and mentoring and coaching and demonstrative pedagogy and the importance of all three. But now I'm going to move to probably the most important insight that I've had and the most important factor in teacher education, which is focus on self. And what does that really mean? Who I am as a teacher matters more than what I teach. It is important to work with teachers as individuals first, fostering a belief in themselves and their capacities. Teachers first need to find their own voice before they can help the others to do the same. So here again, one of my student teachers, her name is Palak, so this is this badge, and she reflected, "I have also realized that children have this amazing way of becoming exactly who we tell them they are. If we tell them they are strong, they will be strong. If we tell them they are kind, they will be kind. If we tell them they are capable, they will be capable." Now, this insight is validated by the work of Rosenthal and Jacobson and is known as the Pygmalion effect. Also, according to John Hattie's famous meta-study, one of the biggest factors affecting student learning is teachers' expectations or beliefs. So this teacher, Palak, a student teacher who is 21 years old right now and actually runs a coaching center in the evening to support her family while she does the program in the day. So when we started the program, we usually start with a 4-day wilderness retreat, and when she came, we didn't hear her at all. It was the first time on the 4th day that we heard her speak. There was a very, very, a huge self-doubt that she came with, low self-esteem, not really knowing if that was the right thing to say or do. And then now she's coming up with such deep insights based on her own experience with children. So we have seen her transformation, her confidence really grow and transform. And the thing is that we believe intrinsically in each one of our teachers. And this belief is carried forward when they work with each one of our students, each child. So we know that when they see themselves transform, they believe that every child can. And this story of Palak was also my story when I was 22 years old. And I was fortunate to have those mentors who believed in me. So I know when Palak will go into the classroom, that belief will be transformative for children that she works with. And that's far more important than the way which she would be teaching English. So now I'm going to help you see that how we can translate all of this into action and briefly talk about the program that we run. So we run a year-long full-time program, and the organization is called I'm a Teacher, and the program is Postgraduate Diploma in Learning and Teaching. And here they are the same four principles that I've spoken about, which forms the backbone of the program. The model that I'm going to speak to you about is really what happens. We are based in 2 cities out of 2 schools. Like I said, practice is extremely critical. We are in American School of Bombay in Mumbai and Heritage Experiential Learning School in Gurgaon. And 3 days a week, our teachers, student teachers, go inside the classrooms and they work with experienced teachers, teachers like Minati Didi that I spoke about. And that's the power of practice that they experience. There's a whole curriculum of practice that we have. So it starts with the gradual release of responsibility from observing what the classroom is, what it looks like, to experience it, to co-planning with the experienced teachers, co-teaching, and then taking some independent charge. And then there is a mentor that is there, a teacher educator or a coach who would help you debrief the practice continuously. So what is it that I'm observing? Why is this important? What is the objective? Why not that? So there is this person who helps you deepen your inquiry or questioning into learning and teaching. And then we have 2 days of practice, 2 days of theory, which is again based on the principle of demonstrative pedagogy. So we believe in doing with our teachers what we want them to do with our students and our children. Each teacher, a lot of learning is individualized, really working with one teacher at a time. And the 4th thing that I've spoken about already is is the work that they do with themselves. I also want to mention here that the assessments, we don't have a single test at the end of the year. They're very, very focused, rigorous practice rubrics. They work on learning portfolios, huge number of reflections and assignments. And of course, the fourth most important thing is working with them as individuals first. It is easy to focus on techniques and strategies and what to do in the classroom, but that's not really the purpose of teacher education. The purpose is to create those teachers who can truly touch lives, who are more empathetic and aware of themselves, people who can balance multiple perspectives and relate deeply with others across traditional lines of difference. Here, this is one of my student teachers, and I'm just kind of showing what she had to say, that how she feels accepted and celebrated for who she is. I'm learning to be an educator who leads by example, transforming myself to reflect the transformation in my children and my peers. A tall order, I know, but Ayat tells me, and I believe I can. So, we all know that nations are built in classrooms, and if we really want to create an India of our dreams, then we need to focus on the classrooms that our teachers are getting prepared in. I'm going to conclude by sharing a few lines that I had penned. Listen to the cry of the womb whose children are suffering. Need we those who can rise from this pain? Take the courage to face themselves, for who they are will shape the new future. Awakened is the teacher in me, believing in the light of each beam. Together we will shine when no longer we hesitate to say, I can, I believe, I can change the world. I am a teacher. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Smriti Chopra Jain, for your four powerful insights of teacher empowerment. She is the co-founder of I Am a Teacher. Thank you very much, and please stay on.
Thank you so much.